You got an interest in wind? Well, this is the place to be, the Wind Museum in Lubbock, Texas. We're going to take a look at that, learn a lot about windmills. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice. Lubbock, Texas, and we're learning about windmills. Tell everyone your name.
I'm Coy Harris. I'm the executive director here.
Okay, we're going to ask you just to kind of continue to show us more about the wind generators here. We have all different kinds of wind generators. I've been spending a little bit of time before with you on this, but I want you to continue to keep showing this. So I'm going to just give you this mic and go ahead and take us around here a little further.
In the 1880s, there was a couple of fellows that got together in Chicago, and they had come up with a wheel design for a windmill, and it would be all metal, and these were some of the first windmills that were actually designed in crude wind tunnels, and they'd come up with a nice design, they came up with a good company name, and they started making windmills in Chicago. Their company was called the Air Motor Company. And it turned out to be the largest of the windmill companies. They're still in business today in San Angelo, Texas. And they made what we would call the Cadillac of the windmill. I mean, it couldn't really build anything any better. And this is a collection right here of every model that Air Motor made from the 1890s right through today. This is a brand new one that was given to us by the Air Motor factory. Back in the back corner, way back there, is one made in 1890. And it looks almost the same, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Why do you call them the Cadillac, though?
Well, because it was the best one,
mm-hmm.
the very best one. And that was a term that was used a lot.
Out of San Angelo, Texas?
They're now in San Angelo. I could actually take the wheel off that one made back there in 1890, and with some slight modification because they changed the gearbox, put it on this one, and it would work exactly the same way.
Wow.
Once they came up with that thing, it could not be really improved, sort of like inventing a hammer. You can't make it any better. They came out with this one. Now, the early windmills, the gearing was open to the air. And you can see on those back here, you see the gears on those? These things turned so fast, they had to gear them down. Well, that meant that you had to climb the tower and grease that. If you were the woman in the house, your husband was in, you know, somewhere, back 40 somewhere. Well, you had to take care of the windmill that was next to the house. If she couldn't get a cowboy to climb the tower and grease it, then she had to do it. So Air Motor came out with this one for her. Disconnect it from the well, and you better stand right there.
Okay.
And she would do this.
Oh, very nice. It just, the whole...
She would lower the windmill down to her, and once it was down at this level, then she could have a short ladder, and she could grease the gears. Tilting tower, and today on a lot of the wind chargers and wind turbines, the small ones, they have tilting towers also, lay down towers. The whole tower actually lays over. This, the midsection lays over. But these were built in the 1880s. And they built these for their windmills up through 1915 until they came out with an enclosed gearbox that had oil in it. You, of course, wouldn't do this to that kind of a gearbox. You'd just dump all your oil out. So this was called, in the time, a woman's windmill because it was easy to operate and she didn't have to climb it.
That's what every wife wanted at that time.
Sure. If her husband wasn't around. Now, another windmill. We've looked at water pumping windmills, but this one is what's called a power mill. This one actually brought down a drive shaft down the tower. And with drive shaft and rotating power at ground level, you can hook up belts and pulleys, and this windmill could drive any sort of equipment.
So the wind would turn...
And you have a line shaft, belts and pulleys, there's a drill press, there's a corn grinder, that's a sorghum press, all sorts of stuff. Anything a gas engine could drive, this windmill could do.
Yes.
And They usually built these on top of the barn. They had all this equipment in the barn. And on a good windy day, you'd go out there and start up.
Look, a windmill. There's a windmill up there.
All right. This is a double sectional wheel windmill and is the only one that's been found.
Wow.
That's left.
Where did you find this?
This was built in the 1880s, and we got this from a collector up near Lamar, Colorado.
Oh, wow.
Very, very rare windmill. And it's beautiful. Now, you see all the moving parts up there? Would you like to get up there and grease all those? Now, while we're standing here looking, that Eclipse windmill right there was off of the big XIT ranch, which was north of Lubbock and covered hundreds of thousands of acres. The XIT used a large number of those 18-footers. And again, the 18-foot refers to the wheel diameter.
Yeah. Well, you talked about the difference between American windmills and those that mm-hmm. were made overseas that had to be serviced all the time. And you had to. Did they have people that actually worked on windmills in America here, though?
Even
though
sure. There were companies that would go around and they would either drill the well for you or they would put the windmills up.
Uh-huh.
And some were very popular.
Would they come back and maintain them on a regular basis?
Well, probably if you asked, they were usually busy putting up the windmills for uh-huh. farmers and ranchers.
Well, some of these were quite intricate. It would seem like somebody that really...
Well, let's go over here and look at one over here, and we'll explain the process. Now, this is a large windmill that came off of a ranch down near Del Rio. This is a 20-foot diameter wheel. It's a Challenge brand windmill. Challenge was one of the big companies out of Batavia, mm-hmm. Illinois, that made windmills. This is big. Now, there were crews that would come out and they'd put these things up. This is before they had crane trucks. This is before they had backhoes. This wheel fit on that gearbox right there, which weighs 4,000 pounds. So you're asking, I hope you're asking, how in the world did they do that?
Yes, get it up there.
What do you think took the longest amount of time to do when they put up a windmill like this?
Get the gearbox up there.
Anybody want to answer? No, sir. A windmill this big had usually a 40-foot steel tower. The steel towers had foundations that required at least 6-foot deep holes per leg.
Yeah.
So no backhoes. You're out there digging a 6-foot deep hole by hand four times. The only way to dig a hole that's 6 feet deep is if you're in the hole. And the only way to be in the hole digging a hole is if it's big enough for the shovel handle.
Mm-hmm.
So you're digging four big holes by hand. And if you're in the soil like we have out here, it's rock hard.
Yeah.
Took a long time to do that. While a couple of guys were digging the holes, they had other guys that were assembling the towers. Sometimes they assembled the towers laying down and then they just simply stood them up. Other times they built the tower in place vertically.
Mm-hmm.
Once they had the tower up, they put a block and tackle on a gin pole sticking up above the top of the tower. The horses of the old pickup that they brought them out there, they'd winch that gearbox up and set it right on top. Didn't take any time at all. Then they'd stand on the platform and assemble the wheel. Took us 2 days to get that wheel there, and we had forklifts and stuff. But those guys knew what they were doing. They were efficient. They took out all their own food. They went to job sites. They had their chuck wagons, and they lived out there putting up windmills. Now, as we walk down this way, more metal mills. This looks like an early wind charger. Well, it isn't. That's a water pumping windmill. Fella saw some of those early wind chargers. Mm-hmm. Let's make a windmill out of that one. So good. Now, you ask, why in the world is there a motorcycle in a windmill museum? This windmill right over here is an Easy. That's the brand name on it. And the owner was making these windmills. He looked out of his window, saw across the street some fellows putting together motorcycles.
Mm-hmm.
And he thought, well, now that's interesting. He went over and bought the company, started making motorcycles and windmills. These turned out to be Cushmans. And Cushman was a very popular brand of motorcycle
mm-hmm.
up through the 1950s.
Mm-hmm.
And this motorcycle was built by that windmill company. So it started as a windmill. And Cushmans were popular until Honda came in and they went out of business. But this is a completely restored Cushman. We drove that in here.
Wow.
Did you have one when you were growing up?
No, I rode them a few times, but never had one.
All right, if you had a windmill, this is what it sounded like. And if you could hear that, you knew you had water. And if it got too loud, then your neighbors would start griping at you to get up there and grease it. These things were marvels of engineering when you say, well, what is this supposed to do? Well, it's supposed to stand out in the wind. It's supposed to rotate. It's supposed to pump water. It's not supposed to break down. And that's what the American design did.
And you'd often see bullet holes in a windmill.
Yeah, like that and that. Now, we've repaired most of them out here on ours, but we left a few of them in here. If these go derelict, then guys with guns will go out and, hey, let's shoot the wheel on the windmill. If they happen to hit the gearbox, they'll kill the windmill because all the oil will leak out and then won't start up again. But typical thing that happens to windmills. Other smaller windmills like these were used in the garden. These are actually water-pumping windmills. Well, now, there's a little bitty one right there that operated a little bitty pump and would pump enough water for your garden.
Wow.
Let's go look at something that's a little bit different from windmills, but is tied to the Windmill Museum.
A lot of these companies came out of Illinois, and yet most of this was done in Texas, Iowa, different places like that.
Well, that's where the market was, but most of the big manufacturing was centered around Chicago.
Okay.
There actually wasn't any windmill manufacturing in Texas until almost the 1900s.
Wow.
This is an area of the museum that we use for different rentals. We do weddings and family reunions, companies. When this building was moved in here, this was a steel fabrication building. Hmm. It was moved in and I redesigned it to fit the windmills a little better. This was their shipping dock in here. We eventually got enough money to enclose it with doors. It had steel corrugated siding in here, which wasn't very pretty. And I thought, well, shoot, let's paint this. I thought, if we're going to paint it, let's paint a picture.
Mm-hmm.
So we commissioned an artist from the university here that teaches at her, named Legina Fairbetter, to paint us a picture. Legina and I sat down and we decided basically what I wanted. Mm-hmm. I wanted a windmill story.
Mm-hmm.
And she and I went over some cartoons, and I said, here's the windmills to use. And then she got up here and painted this 6,000-square-foot mural by hand. Took her 4 years to do this. And it's a windmill story. It starts back over on the right-hand side with the first windmills in America, which were the Dutch style. As people moved west, there's a half dugout over there, they brought their windmills with them. All the towns out west had windmills in the town because there was no central water supply, and that's what this represents. Trains came through. You familiar with Harvey houses that were on the Santa Fe railroads?
No, not too much.
They were really the first of the franchises, and that pink building there where those two ladies in white, they were Harvey girls. And Fred Harvey built Harvey houses along the Santa Fe route all the way out to California, and it was a good place to eat. The girls were nice, and actually the girls provided a lot of the women for marriage to the fellows out west. And a lot of the communities now that have those houses are now restoring those.
Right.
And they're just beautiful structures. That's one that was representative of Las Vegas, New Mexico. Then we come over to these fellows here that are working on an early air motor. Then the time changes again to the 30s and 40s when farmers started replacing their windmills with wind chargers and electricity was available. And then the big northern panel here is current day with the wind turbines. So it is a very interesting windmill mural. It takes a long time to see all the detail in it, but makes a beautiful picture. And then you have, of course, the grounds here.
Let's go out there and take a look.
Let's go out and look at the grass. Texas and, of course, the whole Southwest have been in drought. Until the other night, we hadn't had much more than 1 inch of rain in about 8 months. So everything was dead, except for the grass here at the Windmill Museum, because our grass is watered from our windmills. Windmills outside are in a variety of states because they require a lot of maintenance. And you can see these, we're rebuilding the wheels on some of these early wooden ones. There's a cluster that's back over there. There's six windmills over there. They're on one well. They supply water to a big tank. But this is a beautiful place. Mm-hmm. Come out here and sit on the fence and drink coffee and watch the windmills in the morning.
Some of those that are pointing forward like that, again,
Those are sectional wheel, like these right here. Okay. Well, this has got a section missing. We're fixing that one. The problem that we have with wood these days is that there's no lead-based paints anymore. Mm-hmm. So the wood deteriorates quite rapidly, even though we try to paint them. We have to rebuild these about once every 3 years.
Would people put the name of their farms on there? I see Fairbury, Nebraska.
Fairbury was the manufacturer.
That's the manufacturer.
Yeah.
So.
On some of the windmills, the windmill manufacturer would paint your name on the tail. When you bought a windmill from Sears Roebuck, They would do that for you. But they're all just really pretty. That cluster right over there is America West. They're the largest seller of windmills in the country. And they import windmills from the air motor factory that was down in Argentina. Mm. And the factory's still there. They bring them up here by the container load. They're reworked here a little bit and sold as America West windmills. That's one of every size windmill that company makes. It's got a 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, and 16-foot diameter wheels on. Different tower heights. Really pretty picture-taking opportunities out there. Let's walk right here. We're going to go look at. So we have some wind turbines that represent, again, some of the history of wind turbine development. The one we're standing right in front of is General Electric's very first wind turbine. When they got in the business, this is the machine that they got and was on a mountaintop out in Tehachapi, California. They used it as a test bed machine. When it got to the point that it needed to be replaced, the engineers out there at GE knew about us, and they asked us if we would like to have this particular wind turbine, which of course we did. I went out there and we brought it back. It's sitting right here as a ground display while we try to accumulate some more money. We're going to build a building right here, and I'm going to reassemble this wind turbine inside the building.
Well, what I think is nice about it, the way it's laid out here, is a lot of people see wind turbines up on a tower and they don't realize how big these things are. And the blades are even bigger on some of them these days, aren't they?
Oh, yeah. This is a 1.5 megawatt wind turbine. They're going now to 2 to 2.5 megawatt sizes.
And how much does that increase the turbine size?
Well, this one has 112-foot long blades. Mm-hmm. And you can see how long these things are. The newer ones would have, 150-foot. I mean, they're real monsters.
Yeah,
some of them are getting so big now that they can't even haul them down the road. They're either going to have to be offshore or they're going to have to build them on site. I mean, just real monster machines. That box right there that goes on top of the tower, that weighs 129,000 pounds before you put the wheel on it.
Well, you sure do need something to get.
Let's go down here and we'll look at rising around a balsa wood core.
Yeah.
And then they lay up the fiberglass around that. Now back behind there, we've got some components of a 2.4 Mitsubishi. And that's the hub that's there. We're going to probably get the rest of that wind turbine. But these things are big. And if you want to do the service work on these, you have to climb the towers, get on top, walk around on top, and then sometimes you have to slide around some railings to get into, say, like the hubs here. This is the hub for the GE unit. We've got this covered up, but those bolts there on the end of the blade would bolt right into there. And the way they do these is they'll assemble these on the ground, and they'll use two cranes to pick the wheel straight up and then turn it and stick it on the gearbox.
Now, when does this generator in use? How many years? What year?
This one probably from, I think 2000 up through 2005.
And they've increased in size that much just in those
years. Oh, yeah. Now, the one that we have on our property, this one right up here, is a Vestas. And Vestas was one of the very early wind turbine manufacturers. They started back in the early 80s building wind turbines out of Denmark. This is what's called a V47, and is rated at 660 kilowatts. The GE's 1.5 megawatts, so this one's obviously smaller. That's a 50-meter tower and has a 47-meter diameter wheel. This is one of the first ones that went up inside a city, and there are problems associated with that, trying to do that. This one's connected directly to the museum building. There's no storage, there's no switching gear. The electricity generated from the wind turbine goes into the building. If it can find an outlet somewhere, we use it. If not, it's sold back to the local utility.
The grid intertie aspect of it, yeah.
Works really good. Couldn't afford the storage. And we're doing some service work actually on this one right now. But
yeah, it seems like there'd be enough wind to turn it, but you got it cranked down now.
We've got it. It's in the pitch off position. We're going to go in the base down here. That one will produce over 1 million kilowatt hours a year here. The building uses 100,000.
So you're feeding lot back in.
We feed back 90%.
That's great. Now, what's the cut-in, do you think, on this?
Oh, this one has a cut-in of about 11.
Does it? Yeah.
11 to 12, depending on the, you know, the density of the air and that type of stuff. There's a lot of things that affect these
things. Average wind speed in Lubbock, Texas?
13.5.
Is it? So most of the time you're blowing.
Yeah, this thing works good out here. Here you'll notice up on the hill is our English post mill. So that one was designed in the 1100s in England. So we go from that one to the water pumpers to this really pretty fella right here.
Come a long ways. What do you think the future is going to do as far as wind?
They're going to keep changing the components that the wind turbines are made from, and they're going to change a lot of the mechanics. They're starting to do away with the gearboxes now. They're going to direct drive from the rotor right into the generators. I think we're going to see more of that development. We're going to see a continuation of the size. They're going to keep increasing in sizes. One of the things that we decided to do out here, and you'll see on the ground out here, some small towers. We're going to put in a mini wind farm right on the other side of the Vestas here that'll have between 10 and 15 home size generators. Because it's hard for people to come see these things generally. So we're going to put a whole string of them right over there, all tied together, and they'll, of course, feed back into the building. But then people can come out here and see a variety of these small wind chargers, kick the tower, listen to them.
From different small companies that people may not know.
From all over the world.
All over the world.
We've got 9 of them right now on the grounds. We're going to start assembling and putting these up this month. Let's go inside the big Vestas. Looks like some workmen have been up here and they have not cleaned the...
I see these all over, but very few times get to actually go in them and have it explained how all this works. That's, well, you got a little room in here we go into, right?
Yeah, we don't call it a room. Now, what we're on, we're standing on top of a 30-foot deep foundation. The foundation out here was actually, we couldn't even use a backhoe. We had to drill and jackhammer this hole because the soil was so hard. There's a double row of anchor bolts here on the inside and outside of the tower. Those go down 30 feet. Once those were put in, then the tower was stood up in two sections. Then the wheel was placed on top. All the power comes down these cables right here into the control panel here. There's another one of these upstairs. And then the power goes from here out to a transformer and then over to the building. What's interesting is that these cables right here are tied directly to the generator. There's no slip rings. So you ask, I hope you ask, how does that possibly work? Because the wind turbine is changing direction, spinning around the top of the tower this way, slowly of course. What's it doing to those cables? Well, it's twisting them all up. On the smaller wind turbines, you can actually go out there and unplug the connection and the cables will unwind. This fella keeps track of the number of turns in the cable, gets up to 4, shuts himself down and untwists the cables. It's pretty neat. We come out here one day and say, hey, how come the wind turbine isn't working? And you go over and look at the computer and it says it's untwisting the cables.
I'm at the Wind Museum in Lubbock, Texas, and we're looking at all different aspects of wind. And let's talk a little more about the generating of power in the future. America keeps using more and more power, but we're going to have to make some definite changes. As you indicated, storage is going to have to be worked on. The wind generators are becoming more and more efficient, it looks like, all the way along.
I think they are. And the other thing for, say, inside communities like Lubbock, it's hard to put up wind turbines inside town. For an individual who would like to have their own source of power, probably the best thing for communities, houses in town is going to be solar.
Okay.
And as soon as the solar development comes along where they're making solar panels like they make plate glass,
right,
then we're going to see a big change because then everybody can be their own utility.
Well, in Missouri, what I particularly like is the hybrid system where you have couple wind generators and you have the solar because you know, in the winter and the spring and the fall when the wind may not be blowing quite as heavy, it does a little bit like in the spring and stuff, but I'm saying when the wind dies down, you know, the sun starts picking up.
That's true, except solar doesn't work at night, but maybe the wind will be blowing.
Right.
And that's what I think we're going to see as far as individuals go, is the smaller systems that will supplement what they're doing. If they change their lifestyle a little bit, a lot of those people can live off of solar and wind.
Right, because like we indicated, Ted, you have the days are shorter in the winter time, but the wind's blowing more. The wind blowing more in the spring and in the summer, but and the wind starts slowing down in the summertime, the sun's shining more. So the hybrid systems, there's a lot to be said for connecting both.
I think there's something to say about that, and we're seeing that now with the water pumping windmills. You put in a new well today, you're generally going to put in a solar pump instead of a windmill. They're becoming cheaper, the maintenance on them is a lot less, and they seem to work better.
We're at the Wind Museum. How many people a year actually come out and tour this whole thing and visit it?
We have over 30,000 people a year that are visitors to the museum, have good school programs here. We run little bitty kids through here, not much more than that tall. They have a good time, and then we run a lot of older people through here that remember all of these windmills, what they grew up with.
I guess you hear quite a few stories when they come through.
Oh, we do. We've been writing those down, too.
Have you really?
We have a couple of books with those things in them. Everybody loves windmills. You see pictures of them. They like to take pictures and paint them and draw them. Everybody comes out here and is happy. It's a fun place.
And again, if they want more information on this, they can go to the website at
windmill.com.
Windmill.com. It's pretty easy to find, right in Lubbock.
Well, it's hard to miss all these windmills.
Yes. And if they want further information, they can also call on the number?
806-747-8734. Be glad to have you.
We're at the Wind Museum in Lubbock, Texas, and it's a great place to visit, and been learning all different things about all different types of windmills, and just the significance of and their place in American history. Again, it'd be tough to think of American history without the windmill.
Well, you couldn't come out here and lived unless you had one, so this developed the West.
A lot of the plain states, too.
Oh, it did, and I think we're going to continue to see that as the wind turbines come online that are more cost-effective. They are suitable for houses, not just big utility companies, and we're going to see big changes in that.
Okay. Well, thank you for joining us, and again, we want to thank you for joining us. I'm Larry Rice, and we're continuing to explore the world of wind.